As you could hear, I will try to introduce you to the project I founded, and which actually resulted with a new museum, small museum in a neighboring country, Bosnia and Herzegovina. And this museum is about war childhood. And war childhood is an experience which deeply affected me and my generation. So back in 2010, I decided to do something about this experience. And of course, at that time, I didn't think of a museum, and I didn't have any experience with working in a museum. I was just a visitor to some museums, but I never thought I would work in one or found one. So what I thought about was a book, and the book I wanted to create is actually a mosaic of short recollections that would answer to the question, what was a war childhood for you? So I made a website. It was 2010, 9 years ago. I made a website and asked this very simple question. And the response was really overwhelming. Hundreds of people responded only in the first couple of days. More than 1,500 people responded in the first 3 months. And this, what I thought would be just a small book project, became kind of a movement, managed to create a community of people who shared this experience, and became something really transformative for myself and for some other people. So as I wanted to give opportunity to as many people as possible to contribute to this book, I limited their answers, the space they have to share their memories, to only 160 characters. So like tweets or text messages. And I thought in this way, it would be more fair, more people would be able to participate. But then in another way, it's maybe unfair because it's not enough space to share something what affected you so deeply. So I was trying to balance these two, and in the end, I went for this concept of short recollections and short memories. Memories which I received were really diverse. They were talking about many different aspects of this experience. And one of the first things I learned when I started reading these memories was actually that even though I was a war child myself, I actually didn't know anything about this experience. Because if you spend the war with your parents, you don't really know anything about experience children had in an orphanage. Or if you were a boy, you don't necessarily know how it was to be a girl. Or if you were 7 years old, you don't necessarily know how it was to be a teenager in the war. So here are some of the short recollections I received. As you can see, some of them tell the story about personal loss. Some of them also told stories about friendships, first loves, school, creativity, sports, many different things that children do in any childhood, including the war childhood. But what was really important for me was not the material I received, but rather a communication that I started with these people who contributed. And it is this communication that was actually a source of idea for the War Childhood Museum. Because people, some of them would complain that it's not enough space, and some of them would send me some longer memories, like diaries, letters. Some of them would send an email with 10 pages long memories, and they would say, this is first time I speak about this, although it's 20 years or 15 years at that time since the war ended. So I noticed that people really have a need to share their stories. And I felt they need a platform to tell them. And I felt this project maybe could be that platform. But then again, you know, book is quite limited medium. And it's going to be published, and some people will miss them, will skip, will not even be aware that it's happening. So I thought, what could we do to make it more sustainable? And then some people would send me photos of their objects, personal belongings they preserved from the wartime. And I saw a tendency, I saw that they tend to connect their memories to these objects. And that's actually how the idea for the War Childhood Museum was born. I decided that museum would be this storytelling platform which would continuously and sustainably be documenting, researching on this topic and presenting it to wide audiences. So The logo of the War Childhood book was only a boy holding a balloon, but then we added a girl as well to make it more representative for the community that shares this experience. So the book was published in 2013 after 2.5 years of editing, which was really life-changing process for me, because I thought it would last a couple of months. It lasted over 2 years. The interactions with these people, listening to their experiences. I'm not a psychologist. I was not trained to do this. I was really overwhelmed by this. At that time, I didn't have any team or support, so it was me alone and 1,000 of them communicating 2 years. And I felt a lot of pressure, because soon after I started the project, I felt the whole project might be much more important for others than for myself, because I belong to lucky ones. I didn't lose anyone from immediate family during the war. I was very young, so I was quite protected by my parents. So I realized that there are many of those in the community that care about the project more than myself. And I was waiting for book to be published to see the feedback. And I needed this feedback, because without positive feedback from the community, it would be nonsense to go to the second stage and to create the museum. But the feedback was really, really positive, and the book was accepted as a testament to a collective experience of our generation. And there were hundreds of books after war in our country, but this was the first one that explored the war from the children's perspective and gave opportunity to the whole community to participate. And that's why in 2015, I brought together a team, at the time very small team of only 2 persons, Selma and Amina. Amina is today our executive director, and she's here with us. And our small team started developing methodology for the future War Childhood Museum. No one of us worked in a museum before, so it was a very challenging but also exciting process. All of us were deeply connected to the topic we were dealing with. We had diverse backgrounds: management, medical anthropology, psychology, child rights, history. We invited our friends with these backgrounds to also contribute us and to help us as volunteers. So the team was growing, and we developed methodology, and we started testing it and invited people who participate in the book to be the first ones who would contribute to the museum collection as well. So these are the photos from Sarajevo cafes. It's interesting, we can say that we are the museum which was founded in restaurants and cafes, because at that time we didn't have offices, we didn't have any resources. So we would meet people and we would discuss what they would like to see in the museum, what are their belongings they would like to donate to the museum collection, how they envision them being presented. We really tried to involve community as much as possible. We didn't ask them only these things about their belongings, but also logistical things, how much you think the ticket should be. We wanted this museum to be a place which they really feel it belongs to them, and it's not only something that our team would run. And then the objects, the personal belongings started to come in, and it was so diverse. And here are some of them: from ballet shoes, toys, clothing, Barbie doll. This is an apple made of wax. Different things, including this solar-powered radio, which is just borrowed to the House of European History in Brussels and will be exhibited there for the next 7 years. Each of these exhibits is presented together with a short story from exhibit owner at our museum. And some of you who had opportunity to visit the museum could notice this, and often visitors say that we are the museums of stories and not museums of objects. Although the objects are central to our collection, for us it's really important to tell these stories. And telling these stories is our mission, because it also empowers people who share these stories and empowers these who read the stories when they come to the museum, or they use our mobile app or any other media. As we really try to tell these stories whenever we can, we also prepared some postcards with our objects and stories, so you can become storytellers with us as well. They are in front on the desk, and you can take some of them later. I also want to say that this process of founding a new museum in a very small market, small country, which has only around 25-30 museums in total, was challenging. We have the lowest investment into culture in Europe. And at the time when we started the project of creation of the War Childhood Museum, the main museum in the country, the National Museum of Bosnia and Herzegovina, was closed due to the lack of funding. So some people would, even my friends and colleagues who had good intentions, would tell us, okay, what do you think if you become only an exhibition in a bigger museum, it would be more sustainable, is it really smart to go into this? But we were completely sure, and we knew from the first moment that we want to create small but sustainable and special museum on this experience. What was very supportive and important at the time and in this process was help of volunteers. And here are some numbers. You can see that 30 people contributed to this process with more than 11,000 hours. But these are not low-skilled volunteers. This is mostly professional and expert help. So this is something we couldn't buy, and this is something we couldn't afford at that time. And it had crucial importance to be able to create a museum from scratch. And then, as we were collecting, our collection was growing, we didn't have space. It started to be really challenging to advertise the idea further, to take it to the next step, to ensure funding and space for permanent exhibition, because we were a museum that existed but doesn't exist. You know, if most people, when you say museum, they expect building and they expect permanent exhibition, and we didn't have any of these. So we knew what we are doing, but almost no one in the community and in the audience didn't know. Luckily, we managed to establish trust, so people would still bring the objects to the collection, and I will later tell something about trust and its importance, but still we wanted to show what we are doing. And that's why in 2016, we made first temporary exhibition, 10 days exhibition, and we used it to raise awareness about the project. It was visited by more than 4,000 people, and people started also a campaign. They would take photos with the sign, "I want the War Childhood Museum," and post it on social media. More than 1,000 people did this with our hashtag. And this put pressure to local politicians, which before that they wouldn't even answer to our inquiries to help us find the space or the funding. So as we saw that because of many different things, including age discrimination and everything we faced as we were a very young team, we saw that we cannot wait for politicians to do something for us. We decided to make a big public campaign. So a group of the most famous countries, artists and professionals from the field of culture and museology, they signed a petition for the government to find the space for the permanent exhibition of the War Childhood Museum. And then what happened, and we didn't expect it, is also that football fans of one of the biggest football clubs in the country, they put this 20 meters long banner, "We demand the opening of the War Childhood Museum." And I think this photo speaks a lot about the War Childhood Museum and its ability to reach beyond usual museum audiences. And we are very proud on this, because when we had the first temporary exhibitions, many people who came to visit it didn't know where to find it, and it actually was in the History Museum of Bosnia and Herzegovina, which is one of the two major museums in the country, but those people never went to museum in their life. So luckily, after this campaign, we got this building in Sarajevo's old town, and we completely transformed it. And that's what I love about museums, their ability to transform. So now it looks like this, and this is how it looked inside, and today it hosts our permanent exhibition. And then in January 2017, we finally opened our permanent exhibition. And these are some photos from the opening. And on the one down there, you will see the guy with tears in his eyes. And I want to say that this guy is one of people who contributed their personal belongings to our collection. But also at the time, he was the director of a local IT company that donated mobile app to the museum. And that also speaks of how community helped us to create this museum and why it ultimately belongs to the community. The War Childhood Museum today has three main pillars of activities. It's research, exhibition, and education. Research means we continue to document. Today, we don't work only in Bosnia. We also document experience of Syrian child refugees in Lebanon. We work in Ukraine with internally displaced children from Eastern Ukraine. We work in refugee camps around Serbia, and we have plans to replicate activities in other countries. Exhibition, of course, whatever we document, we try to exhibit and to tell these stories, as I told already, and education, very important for us. Every year now we work with 5,000 children. We do many workshops, we visit schools visit us, and we try to contribute to reconciliation processes in still very much divided society in Bosnia and Herzegovina. But as we know, as tensions are growing all around the world, we hope that War Childhood Museum's materials will become useful much in many, many different countries, not only in ours. Here are some numbers. Until now, we collected more than 3,000 objects. We filmed more than 100 hours of video testimonies. We had 4 temporary and pop-up exhibitions. We have 1 permanent exhibition, and we hosted more than 40,000 visitors until today. We worked with more than 100 schools. More than 13,000 children participated in our educational activities. In 2018, the War Childhood Museum was awarded Council of Europe Museum Prize. I know almost all museums here are here because they won prize, so it's not something special, but it was for us at the time, not so much because of prize, but more because this was kind of opportunity for us as a new small museum to enter the museum community and to connect with people who have similar challenges, similar hopes, who share the optimism that museums can really have important impact in our societies. And war childhood in general, the experience of war childhood is really a transformative experience. It affects your life on so many different levels. But this quote, "a transformative experience," is actually from guestbook from the War Childhood Museum. It's a visitor review of the museum. So what we have done, we took one transformative experience, childhood in war, childhood affected by war, and we made a museum about it, which became transformative experience itself for visitors, for participants, and for us, employees of the War Childhood Museum. So that transformation is something, as I said, I really love about museum. We transformed the physical space where the museum is. The museum completely transformed lives of many people who contributed to its collection, of people who work for the museum, people who visit the museum, and I think this is something very special and unique about museums as interactive spaces that are really able to transform. And now I would like to share a short video with you. I would like you to meet one of our participants who contributed to our collection to see how the War Childhood Museum transforms.
Ja sam Esma Dragičević. Živim i dolazim iz Zavidovića. Rođena sam 43. A otac mi je bio vojno lice, vojnik. Ja sad ne znam kad je došao obavijest o mom ocu da je poginuo, ali znam da je kad sam imala starosti 2 mjeseca, da je poginuo uglavnom tada. Kad izgubite jednog roditelja, onda život odmah krene nekim drugim pravcem. Ja sam, zato što sam imala očuha i sve, jeli, sve je to bilo okej, međutim, ipak je otac meni nedostajao, što je logično i normalno. Ali ja nisam tada znala da se snima, recimo, filmovi ratni. Ja sam toliko išla u sve te ratne filmove gledat, zašto? Zato što sam mislila da ću svog oca vidjeti. Stalno sam buljila, jedan te isti film sam gledala sve dok je trajao, sve. Moje razočarenje, možete zamisliti, kad sam saznala da se snimaju filmovi i da to nije ono pravo, onda sam prestala tragati. Ja sam tek te dokumente, u stvari slike od i ove papire koje ima tu obavijest o smrti mog oca, sve vidjela tu u nekim možda 15-16 godinama slučajno. Jer niko, interesantno je da niko nije pričao o tome. Ono koga nema, nema. Ta bol za ocem je uvijek bila prisutna. I šta god mi se dogodilo, kogod bi me povrijedio, kako bi god bilo, ja sam uvijek plakala po noći i uvijek sam mislila da ja imam oca. To ne bi bilo. Jedno poslije podne slušam, odmaram i slušam radio. I taj dan je bio gost Jasminko Halilović. Ja sam odmah njega našla, kad poslije te emisije, odmah sam ga nađem na Facebooku i odmah mu kažem, pošaljem poruku, da sam slušala i tako i da kažem da svi mi koji smo siročad, koji smo odrasli bez jednog roditelja ili oba, da smo, to je kao kuća bez temelja. On je meni odgovorio odmah, pitao imam li neki papira, nešto šta želim, ja sam rekla imam. I on je mene pozvao da dođem, da to donesem. Za mene je ovaj muzej čudo, čudo. Mislim, to je najbolje što se u Bosni i Hercegovini dogodilo ovih zadnjih 50 godina. Čudo. Zašto? Zato što ja sada kad ovdje vidim svoju sliku oca, kad vidim to sve skupa, ja znam da je on, to isto kao povratak kući, kao da je uskrsnuo.
So, don't be confused, the most of the of our collection comes from the recent conflict in Bosnia from 1990s and belongs to my generation, but as you could see in this short video, this experience brings together people regardless of their age, conflict, which conflict affected their childhood, or regardless in which part of the world. And it's exactly that, the universal aspect of this experience, its universality, that brought so much attention to the project and managed to build that strong community. But obviously the whole process of creating of this museum was not without the challenges itself. And as I know we all here share many of them, I would like just to share a brief overview of what we learned while creating the War Childhood Museum. So I came up with this acronym 2E2T. And 2E2T stands for Entrepreneurship, Equality, Trust and Teams. So when I say entrepreneurship, I notice there is a lot of prejudice in the museum industry towards entrepreneurship and business. People used to connect it with over-commercialization of our institutions. But I'm really not talking about making profits or money here. I am thinking about entrepreneurial mindset, which I believe is very much needed in 21st century for museums to be able to compete with other industries, to compete for funding, to compete for people. And I think it's exactly that, the entrepreneurial mindset that was key for the War Childhood Museum on so many occasions. For example, I mentioned our struggle to find the space and the funding for permanent exhibition. And what I would do, I would go to a local government and I would say, I have funding, just give me the space. And I would the same day go to the donors and I would say, I almost secured the space, I just need funding. So it's this continuous strive to build things, to create things, which I think it's really important. The not only relying on already ensured resources, but relying on trust you put in your team that you will still make it, although resources are limited or non-existent. I think that's the environment we work on, and I think we just need to embrace this and to try to embrace entrepreneurial mindset in museum leadership. And then equality. When I say equality, I really mean broadly human rights, promoting human rights. I think in the time we live in, there is a huge responsibility museums have. We live in time of mounting extremism. Our societies are divided and in so many ways. And I think museums, tens of thousands of museums around the world with millions of visitors on a daily basis, have a great platform to promote equality. And when I say this, I don't mean only history museums promoting rights of refugees. I can imagine art museums finding ways to promote rights of refugees, toy museums promoting gender rights. I think it's really shared responsibility of the whole industry. And then trust. It was key for the War Childhood Museum, really, because as I mentioned, we were creating the museum which was completely invisible. And if we couldn't create the trust with the community, we would never be able to get the objects and create the collection. Because for some of these people, they entrusted us their most precious personal belongings, often the only thing they preserved from the wartime or the only thing that they keep as a memory on a lost member of family. And also the aspect of trust we often forget is self-trust. And I think it's very important that museum leaders and museum professionals have the self-trust about the importance of our institutions, about the role our institutions can play in the society. We need to act with more confidence to be able to compete with other industries. And also the trust towards all stakeholders towards to build trust with the audiences. Audiences have big expectations nowadays. In the time of fake news, they expect museums to present with credibility, with confidence. And when they enter the museum, they want to know they enter the safe place, which they can trust. And research shows that people trust museums more than media, than government agencies. We need to be aware of this. We need to feel this responsibility, but also we need to use that potential to influence the society. And the last is teams. I really think it was crucial for the World Childhood Museum, and I think it's crucial for all our museums, because before we lived in times when people were educated to work in museums, but now we live in the time when people are educated to add additional value, to create new value in any industry, and we need to compete with industries that have many more resources. And that's why I think it's important to diversify teams, to be able to compete, and to provide a vision that teams would follow. And the last message is that I really think that the future belongs to museums. And I root this optimism in the fact that when we talk about future, we usually think about young. And in this video, you could also see that museums can influence the future of old. And I think I will not ask you to remember the World Childhood Museum, because there are so many great museums and presentations you would see here, and you will remember some of them. But I will ask you to remember that old lady Esma and things she told us. And when she entered the World Childhood Museum, she told us, after 70 years, I feel I finally found my home. And that's huge for us. And I think it's not only for the World Childhood Museum, but that fact that we can influence lives of people to that extent, I think that's why museums are powerful and why the future belongs to museums. Thank you. Wow.